In this lecture, we will discuss about the resolving power of prism. So it is defined as the capacity of the prism to form separate spectral lines of two wavelengths, and these two wavelengths, they are very near to each other. So the definition of the resolving power in the case of prism is same as that of the diffraction grating. So the resolving power is defined as, it is given by the formula lambda divided by d lambda. So this is the expression of resolving power, and this we have also seen in the case of diffraction grating. So the resolving power is defined as the capacity to form separate spectral lines of two wavelengths, and these two wavelengths, they are very near to each other. So one wavelength that we will take is lambda, and another wavelength that we will take be lambda plus d lambda. And over here, this d lambda is such that the spectral lines which are formed, these spectral lines or the diffraction patterns which are formed on the screen, they are such that the principal maxima of one falls on the first minima of the another spectral line. So from here we will get d lambda. So d lambda is the minimum difference in the wavelengths of the two lights, so that Rayleigh criteria is satisfied. So over here, the shown is a prism, and the prism, the thickness of the base is given by B to C length, and it is given by this small t. So t is the thickness of the base of the prism. And over here we have taken the front section of the prism. The front section of the prism is only shown over here. So from a source, two wavelengths of lights, they are made to fall on this prism. So here is the prism L1. Here is the lens L1, and here is another lens L2. So the light rays, they are made parallel to each other with the help of this convex lens, and these light rays which are parallel, they are made to converge on any point on the screen with the help of this another lens. So with the help of this lens L1, the two wavelengths which are coming from the source S, so let's say one wavelength is lambda and another wavelength is lambda plus d lambda. So two wavelengths, they are made to fall on this section, on this face of the prism. And after traveling through the prism, the two wavelengths, they will obviously, they will change their paths, and they will no more be parallel to each other. And this is because for different wavelengths, the prism, the material of the prism will show up different refractive index. So if the wavelength, if you will increase the wavelength, the refractive index will decrease, and this we already know. For example, I have shown over here that the orange light, this orange light which is shown, let's say it has wavelength lambda plus d lambda. And this blue color light, it has less wavelength as compared to the orange wavelength. So therefore, we will denote it by lambda wavelength. So wavelength of the blue color light is shown by lambda, and the wavelength of this orange color ray is given by lambda plus d lambda. So if you change the wavelength, as you can also see that this orange ray, is bent less as compared to the blue ray. The blue ray has bent more as compared to the orange ray, which means that the refractive index for the case of blue ray is more as compared to the refractive index for the case of orange ray. So therefore, there is a difference in the wavelengths. So let's say the wavelength for lambda light, for lambda wavelength, let's say the refractive index is given by mu. And for the case of lambda plus d lambda, the refractive index will decrease. So let's say it is mu minus d mu. So this refractive index will be used later on. So over here, I have shown that the two light rays, firstly, these two light rays, they were coming from the same source. But after getting refracted from this prism, the two light rays, they will change their path, and one wavelength will be bent more as compared to the another wavelength. So let's say this is the angle which is made between the two rays, and let's denote this angle by d theta. So d theta is the angle which is made by these two wavelength of lights. And this d theta is such that when these rays, they are made to fall on this second lens, converging lens, then they will get converged, and they will get converged in such a way that the maxima of one will fall on the first minima of the another. So this d theta angle is such that the Rayleigh criteria is satisfied on the screen. So as this orange light ray, it gets converged at this point. So let's say this is the P1 point. So orange light ray, it gets converged at P1 point, and central maxima will be formed over here. This blue ray, this blue colored light ray, it falls on another point because obviously it is bent by a certain angle. So on the screen also it will get converged at another point. So let's say that point is P2. So at P2 point, the another light ray will get converged and will form its central maximum. So this d theta angle is such that the Rayleigh criteria is satisfied. That is that at P1 point, if you have maxima of one wavelength, then at same P1 point, we have minima of the another wavelength. As you can see, the intensity of the blue light, it decreases and goes to zero. So at P1 point, we have minima of blue light, as well as at the same point P1, we have the maxima of orange light, and similar thing happens at P2 point also. So at P2 point we have maxima of blue light, but at the same point P2 we have minima of the orange light. So therefore this d theta angle, or you can say this is d lambda difference in the wavelength, is such that the Rayleigh criteria condition is satisfied. So this will help us in finding the resolving power. So to find out the resolving power of a particular prism, what we will use is, we will use Fermat's principle. So we will see what this principle states. But before that, what we are going to see is what is the expression of this d theta angle. So for that, let's draw a perpendicular from this point C point on the blue ray. So let's draw a perpendicular from this C point onto the blue ray. And let's say that this whole length is equal to small b. This whole length, let's say, is equal to small b. And in the case of telescope, what we had seen was that the light rays from two objects was falling on the objective of the telescope. So these were the light rays from one object which was kept far away from the telescope, and the light rays from the another object, they were falling at a certain angle. So let's say these are the light rays which were falling on the objective of the telescope, but from the another object. So these light rays, which are shown by bold lines, these are the light rays coming from another object, and these light rays, they will be parallel to each other, because in the case of telescope we keep the objects far away from the objective lens. Therefore the light coming from those objects is almost parallel to each other, and similar is the case for the first object. And there we saw that the light from the object, it fell on whole length of the lens. It fell on the whole aperture of the lens, which means that the whole diameter, let's say the diameter of the lens was a small d, and this angle which was made between the rays coming from two different objects, it was equal to theta. So this whole lens was covered with the light. This whole lens, it was covered with the, it was illuminated with the light coming from the objects. So from there, we got the expression of theta, and theta, it came out to be equal to, in the case of telescope. So I am talking about telescope, I am not talking about the prism over here. So in the case of telescope, theta was the angle which was made between the two rays, and the whole lens was covered with the whole lens was illuminated with the light coming from the objects. So d was the diameter of the whole lens, and in that case theta came out to be equal to lambda divided by small d. So this was the expression that we got in the article of resolving power of telescope. So that came out to be in the case of telescope. So d was the diameter of the whole objective lens, because whole objective lens was illuminated by the light coming from the objects, and theta was the angle which was made between the two rays which are coming from two different objects. So this was the formula that we got over there. And now in the case of prism, the same thing is happening. Here we have a lens. Here we have a lens, and this lens, it resembles this lens of the telescope, and light rays, they were falling on the lens of the telescope. These light rays, they were falling on the lens of the telescope, and similar thing is happening over here also. The light rays, one wavelength, these orange colored rays, they are falling on the telescope, as well as the blue rays, they are falling on the telescope. And over here theta was the angle between the two kinds of rays coming from two different objects. And over here also these two rays, one is of wavelength lambda plus d lambda and another is lambda wavelength. So these two rays, they are falling on the on this lens L2, and d theta is the angle between these two rays. Similarly, in the case of telescope, we had theta angle, and lambda was the wavelength of the light falling on the lens, and d was the diameter of the objective lens, because whole lens was illuminated by the light. So it acted as a circular aperture. So similar thing will happen over here. Now this perpendicular which we have drawn over here, and we have denoted it by small b. Now these light rays, these blue colored light rays, these are falling on this section of the prism only. These blue colored light rays, these are falling on a small portion of the lens. It is not falling on the whole lens. So it is only falling on the region which is equal to b length. So this will be almost parallel to this one, and this perpendicular, it has a length equal to small b. So these light rays, when they will fall on this lens L2, so they will just cover this b length on the lens. So they will cover b length on the lens. So in this case, if we will use this formula, the same formula that is in the case of telescope, where the whole lens is illuminated by the light, in that case we use the whole diameter. But in this case, this b length is only illuminated, this b length of the lens L2 is only illuminated by the light. Therefore in this case we will use b instead of small d. So we will use small b instead of small d. Lambda will remain the same, and in this case we had theta, but here we have d theta. D theta is the angle which is made between the two kinds of light rays. Over here also the two kinds of light rays, they made up an angle of theta. So what we will have from this formula? So in the case of prism, theta will change to d theta, lambda will remain the same, divide by, here we have small d, but over here only b length of the lens is illuminated by this blue color light, so we will use small b. So this is the formula that we will use in the case of prism. So d theta, it came out to be equal to lambda divided by small b, where b is the length of this perpendicular which is drawn from this point to the one of the rays, to one of the rays. So it can be orange light ray or it can be blue light ray. So now we are going to find out the formula of lambda divided by d lambda, because we want to find out the expression of the resolving power of prism. So for that we will use Fermat's principle, and we will see how Fermat's principle, it will help us in finding the expression of lambda divided by d lambda. Now what will be the criteria to find lambda divided by d lambda? What will be the criteria to find out the resolving power of prism? So in this case, using Fermat's principle, we will find the expression of d theta. So using this concept of telescope, we have already found out the expression of d theta, which is given by lambda by small b. So using this Fermat's principle, we will find another expression of d theta. Then we will equate those two equations, and from there we will get lambda divided by d lambda expression. So now we will see what is Fermat's principle. So here I have drawn a wavefront. So this is nothing but the wavefront for the case of blue light. And if I draw a wavefront from this point onto the incident ray, so these are the incident rays, and I will draw a wavefront. So for wavefront, I always draw a perpendicular line. So perpendicular line is always drawn if we want to show up the wavefront. And this is the wavefront for the case of blue light. So similarly for the case of orange light also, I can draw a perpendicular from this C point. So this will be the wavefront for the case of orange light, and this will be the perpendicular. So over here, this is the incident wavefront, and these two are the emergent wavefronts. This is the incident wavefront, and these are the emergent wavefronts or wavefronts of the emergent light. Now, what is Fermat's principle? Fermat's principle states that the optical path of the rays between incident and the emergent wavefronts. So here we have incident wavefront, and here we have shown the emergent wavefront. So the emergent wavefronts that we have shown over here, one is this one and another is this one. So two emergent wavefronts have been shown over here, and incident wavefront is just one. So Fermat's principle states that the optical paths of the rays between the incident and the emergent wavefronts must always remain the same. The optical path which is traveled by a particular wavelength of light between its incident wavefront and its emergent wavefront is always the same. So if I talk about orange light travels this path and then this path up to this point. So let's consider this point. This point on the orange light is given by E, and this point which is touching the blue line is given by G, and this point is given by D. And let's consider this is F point. So BF is the incident wavefront, CE is the emergent wavefront for the case of orange light, and CD is the emergent wavefront for the case of blue light. So we have two emergent wavefronts and we have only one incident wavefront. So Fermat principle say that the optical path traveled between the incident and the emergent wavefront remains the same for a particular wavelength of light. So for a particular wavelength of light, let's say I'm just talking about the orange light. So orange light travels FA then AE distance. So FA plus AE is the distance, or you can say is the optical path traveled by the orange light between the incident and the emergent wavefront. So FA plus AE is the optical path traveled by the orange light, or you can say the light which has wavelength lambda plus d lambda between the incident and the emergent wavefront. So another optical path which is traveled by this same orange light, another optical path is nothing but B to C. So one path that I have taken is from F point to E point for the case of orange light, and the other path which orange light travels is from B to C point. So this is the incident wavefront. So incident wavefront touches over here and emergent wavefront touches over here. So this is also another optical path which is traveled by the orange light from B to C. So this thickness which we have said already, that this thickness of the prism is given by small t. So B to C distance is also traveled by the orange light, and from F to E distance is also traveled by the orange light between this same incident and the emergent wavefront. So these two optical paths, they should be the same. So Fermat's principle says that the optical path of the rays between the incident and the emergent wavefronts must be the same. Between the incident and the emergent wavefronts must be the same. So from F to E point, F to A then to E point is one optical path traveled by the orange light, then from B to C point is the another optical path traveled by the orange light. So we will use the Fermat principle for the case of orange light also and for the case of blue light also. And one more thing, in your examination you do not have to write that this is the orange light and one is the blue light. Over there you simply have to use lambda plus d lambda ray. That one ray with lambda plus d lambda wavelength and another ray is having lambda wavelength. So these colors I have just shown over here to make you clear that one wavelength is greater and it will bend less as compared to the another ray. So these are just to make you clear. In your examination, you just have to mention lambda plus d lambda and lambda. And for the case of lambda plus d lambda, the refractive index of the material will be mu minus d mu, and For the case of lambda wavelength, the refractive index which is shown by this material will be just equal to mu. So now we will use Fermat principle for lambda plus d lambda wavelength also, as well as for the lambda wavelength. So for the case of lambda wavelength, or for the case of this blue ray which I have shown, so for if we will use Fermat's principle, so what are the optical paths which we can use? One is the optical path from F point to A point, then from A to this D point, because this is the point where the wavefront of the blue light touches. So this is the point where the base of the perpendicular touches this ray. So one optical path which is traveled by the blue light between the incident and the emergent wavefront is from F to A point, then to D point. Then another optical path which is traveled by this same wavelength of light is from B to C point. So this optical path is same for the case of orange light also, as well as for the case of blue light. The difference will come only in this path at the top, because the wavefront of orange light touches over here and wavefront of the blue light touches over here. So there comes a difference in the path. So now we will use the Fermat's principle over here. So we will use Fermat's principle, and it states that the optical paths of the rays between the incident and the emergent wavefronts must be the same. So I have shown only this part of the diagram which I had drawn on the previous page. Only this portion I have shown over here. So this is the prism ABC. The thickness of the base is given by T, and the wavefront that we had drawn, incident wavefront, it touches the point F. Then the emergent wavefront drawn from this C point, the emergent wavefront, it touches the orange ray at this point, and we had denoted this point by E. Then the emergent wavefront for the case of blue light touches over here, and this point was denoted by D. So this point is also given another alphabet, is denoted by capital G, and this angle was given by D theta. So naturally, if this angle is d theta, if this angle is d theta, then this angle which is made between the two wavefronts, this angle will also be equal to d theta. So if this is the d theta angle, then this small angle will also be equal to d theta. Now we will use Fermat's principle for the case of lambda light also, as well as for the case of lambda plus d lambda. So firstly, for the case of lambda plus d lambda, the refractive index shown by the material of the prism will be less as compared to the refractive index shown to this lambda wavelength. So this refractive index shown to lambda plus d lambda is given by mu minus d mu, and the refractive index shown to the lambda wavelength will be just mu. So now we will use the Fermat's principle. So firstly, we will use the Fermat's principle for the case of lambda wavelength, and lambda wavelength is this one, blue one. So what is the Fermat's principle? It states that the optical paths of the rays between the incident and the emergent wavefronts, they must be the same. So first optical path will be from F to A point, then from A to D point, because we are talking about lambda wavelength light, and this is this blue color ray. So the optical path will be from F to A point and then to D point. So this is the first optical path which is traveled by the blue color light ray between the incident and the emergent wavefront. And another optical path which is traveled is from B to C point. And you can clearly see that this path which is traveled by the blue light ray is in the material of the prism. The other optical path which we had talked about earlier, it was from F to A, then from A to D, and this path is traveled in vacuum, whereas this path is traveled inside the material of the prism, and the material of the prism, it shows mu refractive index for the case of lambda light, because we are just talking about lambda wavelength right now. So for the case of lambda wavelength, the refractive index shown by the material of the prism is given by mu. So what will be the path traveled from B to C point, from B to C point for the case of lambda light? So from B to C point, the path traveled will be, the optical path traveled will be equal to refractive index multiplied by the geometrical path. So what is the geometrical path? It is nothing but equal to T. So this is nothing but the geometrical path. But what will be the optical path traveled by the blue color light ray, or you can say traveled by the lambda wavelength light ray? It will be equal to refractive index times the geometrical path. So optical path will be mu times t, because mu is the refractive index shown to this lambda wavelength light by this material. So the optical path traveled from B to C point by the blue color light ray will be equal to mu times t. So using the Fermat's principle for the case of lambda wavelength light. So firstly, the optical path traveled between the incident and the emergent light ray for the case of lambda light will be equal to FA plus AD. So first optical path which is traveled by the lambda wavelength light between the incident and the emergent wavefronts is FA plus AD. So this is the first optical path, and this is nothing but equal to the optical path from B to C point, and that is nothing but mu times t. So that is nothing but mu times t, and we have equated these two paths because this is what the Fermat's principle states. It states that the optical paths of the rays between the incident and the emergent wavefronts must be the same. So this is the first optical path between the incident and the emergent wavefront, and mu into t is the another optical path for the same wavelength of light from B to C point. So this is the another optical path. So we have equated these two optical paths between the incident and the emergent wavefronts. So similar thing we can write for the lambda plus d lambda. So for the case of lambda plus d lambda, what is the first optical path? It is F to A, then A to E point, because we are looking at lambda plus d lambda wavelength light. That is, we are talking about this orange ray. So first optical path between the incident and the emergent wavefront is FA plus AE. So it is FA plus AE, and that is equal to the optical path traveled by the orange light ray from B to C point. So the optical path will be refractive index into the geometrical path. Geometrical path is nothing but t, but what is the optical path? It will be refractive index times the geometrical path, and refractive index shown by the material to this lambda plus d lambda wavelength light is mu minus d mu. So this will be equal to refractive indexes mu minus d mu into the geometrical path. So this will give us the another optical path traveled by this orange light ray from B to C point. And this is the first optical path traveled to this same wavelength of light from F to E point. So now we will subtract these two equations. So let's consider this is the first equation and this is the second equation. We will subtract these two equations. So we will get FA will cancel with FA, and we will get AD minus AE. So this equation will be subtracted. So second equation is subtracted from the first equation. You will get AD minus AE, and that will be equal to mu t as it is minus of mu minus d mu into t. So it will be mu t minus of mu t, then plus of d mu into t. So it will cancel with this one, and you will just get t into d mu. So this AD minus AE comes out to be equal to t into d mu. Now what is AD? AD is this length. And what is AE? AE is this length. So over here we will use the approximation that this AE length will be approximately equal to this AG length. This d theta angle is very very small. Therefore this AE length can be put approximately equal to AG. So AE is approximately equal to AE is approximately equal to AG length, because d theta angle is very very small. So over here you will get AD minus, instead of AE we will write AG. So it will be equal to T into d mu. Now AD minus AG. So this is AD, AD minus AG will be just equal to this small length, and that is nothing but GD. So GD will come out to be equal to T into d mu. Now we will look into this triangle. We will look into this triangle over here. So it is like this. So this point is G, this point is D and this is the C point on the prism, and this angle we have already said this will be equal to D theta, and this is the perpendicular which we had drawn. This was the perpendicular and this length was taken equal to B, this length which was taken as equal to B on the previous page, and this GD length we have already calculated. This GD length is equal to D mu into T. So this we have already calculated. So over here we will use the property of a circle. So here we have an arc, and here is the radius of a circle. This can be considered to be the radius of a circle, and this is the angle which is subtended at the center of the circle by this arc GD. So according to the property of the arc, the angle which is subtended at the center of the circle by this arc is equal to the length of the arc divided by the radius of the circle, and that is equal to B. So this can be considered as the radius of the circle, and this is the small arc which subtends angle D theta at the center of this circle. So GD is nothing but equal to, so D theta will be equal to, what is GD? It is equal to D mu into T divided by small b. So this is the expression that we get of D theta. And the first expression that we have already got of D theta using the similarity from the telescope, it was equal to lambda divided by small b. So this was the another expression of D theta. So we will equate these two equations. So what we will get is D mu into T divided by b, D mu into T divided by b, it will be equal to lambda divided by b. So this b and b, they will cancel with each other, and we will just get lambda will be equal to d mu into t. So over here we will divide these two sides by d lambda. We will divide these two sides by d lambda. So we will get lambda by d lambda is equal to d mu divided by d lambda into t. It will remain as it is. So this is the final expression of the resolving power of prism that we will get using the Fermat's principle. So this is the expression of the resolving power in the case of prism. So from this expression of the resolving power of prism, we can conclude that the resolving power of prism, it varies directly with the width of the base of the prism. So T was the width of the base. So this length is the width of the base of the prism. So resolving power, it varies directly with the width of the base of the prism, as well as it varies with d mu divided by d lambda. It varies directly with d mu divided by d lambda, and this d mu divided by d lambda, it can be called as rate of change. It can be called as d mu divided by d lambda is the rate of change of refractive index. So here we have d mu divided by d lambda. So this is called as rate of change of refractive index with respect to wavelength. So with wavelength, so refractive index of prism, it varies directly with the width of the base of the prism, as well as it varies directly with the rate of change of refractive index with respect to the wavelength for the material which we are using in the case of prism.